He would have turned 70 years this May, so we thought it's really a reason to celebrate his work, his tremendous body of work. We want to introduce his new work and discuss his relevance for the new generation of theater makers. We will start with an introduction of his work by Frank Henschker, the director of the Segal Center, followed by a Skype interview with Juliane Lawrence, who was Fassbinder's late partner in life, and editor of his last films, and she's the president of the Fassbinder Foundation. Then we have excerpts of three of his plays, followed by a short discussion with the directors. And then we have a really brief reception for all of you to gather and hang out and talk with all of us. So the evening shouldn't be longer than 90 minutes. Please take a moment to take out your cell phone and see that it's off. That's important. So, and then I think that's it. Let me introduce you to Frank Henschker, who will give a brief introduction into his theater work.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming out tonight to the Quality Center. CUNY here, well, we all know that, you know, there's a strange atmosphere in the room, in the world, in the city, you know, after those Paris events, and people are a bit more careful to come out, but I think it is important that we all continue lives as we do, and in New York it's perhaps not as present as it is in Paris, but still we got a mail from FIAF, our friends, the French Alliance Française, who we collaborate with a lot, and Lily Chopin, who creates also the Crossing the Line Festival, and she wrote me a little note and asked me to read it. So I will ask for a moment of silence afterwards. Dear New York friends, we sadly know what it is to wake up to the reality of a world under attack. But we have learned something from our own tragedies. It is essential to be resiliently joyful and connect to one another with empathy. Our friends and family in Paris need our strength and our love. Do not let fear overcome their hearts, but instead bring determination to continue to live their lives as they always have in the city we all adore. So we have a short moment of silence. It was actually a cultural event, a concert that was attacked. So. Thank you all. So now let's come to the theme of our evening. We already had two screenings about Rainer Werner Fassbinder, who most of us know as the great filmmaker, but whose life and work was so closely connected to the theater. And this event is here to remind us of all of it. I'm going to read a few notes. I wish I could say I have written them. And they mostly come also from Juliane Lawrence, his last partner, who we're going to hear from later on. Rainer Werner Fassbinder was a German film director, screenwriter, and actor, and he was one of the most important figures in New German cinema and also in German theater. Fassbinder maintained a frenetic pace in theater and filmmaking. In a professional career that lasted less than 15 years, and I just want to emphasize less than 15 years, he completed 40 feature-length films, 2 television film series, 3 short films, 4 video productions, 24 stage plays and 4 radio plays, and 36 acting roles in his own and others' films. He worked as an actor in film and theater, author, cameraman, composer, designer, editor, producer, and theater manager. Underlying Fassbinder's work was a desire to provoke and to disturb. His phenomenal creative energy when working coexisted with a wild, self-destructive libertinism that earned him a reputation as the enfant terrible in New German cinema, but also was in the theater world, and to be one of its central figures. He had a tortured personal relationships with the actors and technicians around him, who formed a surrogate family. However, his pictures and his plays demonstrate his deep sensitivity to social outsiders and his hatred of institutionalized violence. He ruthlessly attacked both German bourgeois society and larger limitations and failures of humanity. Fassbinder died on June 10, 1982, at the age of 37, from a lethal cocktail of cocaine and barbiturates. His death has often been cited as the event that ended the new German cinema movement. Fassbinder was born in Bavaria, in a very small town, on May 1945, just 3 weeks after the Allied forces occupied the town, and 3 weeks after the unconditional surrender of Germany. The aftermath of World War II deeply marked his childhood and the lives of his family. He was the only child of Lieselotte Pempeit, a translator, and Helmut Fassbinder, a doctor who worked out of the couple's apartment in Sendlinger Straße in Munich, next to the Red Light District. Fassbinder's parents were cultural members of the Munich society. His father mainly concentrated on his medical career, but he also followed his passion of writing poetry. His mother worked in the practice. The family divorced, the parents divorced in 59, and in order to support herself and her son, Lieselotte had to take in boarders, rented out rooms, and found employment as a German to English translator. So the father did poetry and the mother was a translator. When she was working, she often sent her son to the cinema in order to concentrate. And later in life, Fassbinder claimed that he saw nearly every day in his young life a film, and he claimed to see one day even three, four, or even five films. Fassbinder was looked after by his mother, tenants and friends. When his mother wasn't there, she suffered from tuberculosis and had to go away for longer periods of time. And he often clashed with his mother's younger friend, boyfriend Siggy, who also had a difficult relationship with the much older journalist Wolf Eder, who became his stepfather. As a teen, Fassbinder was sent to a boarding school, and three times he tried to escape and eventually left school before final examination. At the age of 15, he moved to Cologne to his father. They argued a lot, but he tried to go to night school to finish his high school diploma. To earn money, he worked small jobs and helped his father, who rented shabby apartments to immigrant workers, and he began to write short plays, stories, and poems. At the age of 18, Fassbinder went back to Munich with his plans to attend night school because he wanted to do theater studies, actually something we do here at the Graduate Center. And for 2 years, following his mother's advice, he studied acting in a Munich school, a very good one, but actually failed the exam as one of the very few actors who ever did. He made small films, 8mm films, and applied to the Berlin Film School. And he also was rejected and did not get in, as did Bernard Schulte or Rosa von Braunheim, two significant filmmakers later. He returned to Munich, he did not give up, he continued writing, made short films, and his mother played many parts in her son's films, and he was still an important figure in his life. In Munich, where Fassbinder couldn't find money to do his films, he joined the Munich Action Theater, the Action Theater, where he became active as an actor, director, and scriptwriter. After 2 months with the company, he became its leader, and he staged his first big play, which was called Katzenmacher, the story of a foreign worker from Greece who became the object of intense racial, sexual, and political hatred among a group of Bavarian slackers. A few weeks later, the Action Theater was disbanded, and his rise within the group was met with jealousy from the founders. He left the company and founded his own theater, which was called the Anti-Theater, or the Anti-Theater. So it's a theater that's called a theater, but it was the Anti-Theater. And there was a group that lived and worked together. They all saw a production of the Living Theater of Judith Malina and Julian Beck, and that inspired them. And the group of young actors that worked together did film, but also theater work, and like an ensemble in theater that works on every play, they worked together on films and became most of them very, very famous. Among them, Hanna Schigula, who we met in the acting school, where he failed, and Irm Herman, who became also his first wife, but also an important member of his company. She started as a secretary, and he forced her to do acting. In the space of 18 months, he directed 12 plays. Of these 12 plays, he rewrote five other plays and took, then, I don't know, three plays, how they really were. The style of his stage directing closely resembles that of his early films, a mixture of choreographed movement and static poses, taking its cue not from theater or theater tradition. He never went really to a directing school, but more from musical cabaret film, especially French film, and from what happened on the streets in the student movement. Maybe it's would be a good time. Here we saw him, and here's some of the stage design of the early scenes. Maybe a good moment to show one of the clips we have. Maybe we could start with the Katzelmacher. It won't be long because we had a screening in the afternoon, but I think it's good to see for a second how that looked like, how it felt like, and we listened to the German words. And Fassbinder always continued to work in theater, even so as a film director. He became very famous. What was important to him to form a collective, as he called it, almost a commune. They worked together, they shared everything. But he was such an overpowering and strong personality that it became clear that what used to be a traditional thing, that he was a kind of a director or a leader, which he didn't really want to, it became clear actually this is what everybody expected of him. And he was became the face of that theater company. So this will be from his first play that then also became a movie. And in that time, whatever he wrote for the stage also became a movie. Or whatever he wrote as a movie, he could produce it, became a stage play. He didn't see any difference. And this is in the back of a pub. That's still a bar. You see in the back, there is a drawing of the city. And people are drinking coffee, eating wurst and sausage and sauerkraut. And they were just there.
Der ist der und ich bin ich.
And everything was static. He didn't move the camera. The only time it moved when he had his walks. You see, it's highly stylized. I don't understand anything. I need to learn, she
said.
Maybe we can go on to the next clip, Das Kaffeehaus. As you see, they had no money, they had no time, they had no space. And this actually informed their aesthetics and their work. And as he said earlier in the afternoon films, he did with something with what he had, as Brecht said, Bertolt Brecht, you have to do the house with the stones you have. He asked his friends, his mother, his people, he went to the back of Bart and created his place. And felt that this is the way to do art. And there's no separation between life and art. So this is after Carlo Goldoni. I don't know, he's a famous Italian writer who wrote in the tradition of commedia dell'arte, something you don't expect at all from Fassbinder. And in one of the rehearsals, he came in and said, you all do whatever you want, take a chair, sit down, whenever you feel like speaking a sentence or saying something from what you remember from the play, just do that. Maybe you can go a little bit forward.
Das Arbeiten ist wirklich für...
See, nothing really happens. Still the same, let's go a little forward. Just listen how flat you think the words are.
Ein Gehirn bei dem hier vor, wie sie 6 Schillinge, 7 Pence, 1505 Mark.
Weil ein Köpfchen hat. So goldig.
So very democratic movement. Let's go to the next one, Bremer Freiheit, the play. You see, he said to be very democratic. You decide what to say, when to say. Very bare-bone aesthetics. One could even see the Pina Bausch, which he later on filmed. In his only documentary he made. And he, in 1974, took over a famous theater complex. It was called Theater am Turm in Frankfurt. Actually, I still remember that. I worked there for a little while, and it was legendary. Not only Joseph Beuys did a performance with a horse on stage there, Fassbinder was there for a while and disregarded every business aspect of it. And scandal of the talk about this. Maybe also go a little bit up front. It's also famous places we also hear tonight. So we have an excerpt from that. So basically, this is the stage play with a projector, and he said that's a film. Sound until I finish. So here you also see highly stylized movement, and he didn't see any big difference. The way he directed that, his actors on stage or the film was the same. He did mostly blocking. You go here, you go from here. He never told an actor what to do. He believed in them. He said, you know already what you do, and they had to learn over time. Fassbinder was known as also a one-take director in film. He would say, this is the scene, you're an actor, do it, you have one chance, put in everything you have or you can do. And this is also one of the reasons why he was so successful in producing so many works at such a fast pace. And as we all know, they do a lot. This is how you get good at things and put things
Rainer,
out.
Last few question. I'm sorry I didn't remember.
Yeah.
Do you know who translated this?
I don't know.
You don't know?
We find out. That's
okay.
For you. Okay. He took over this 1974 theater, and it was a very big scandal. He wrote a play which called City, Garbage, and Death, which was about a real estate tycoon in Frankfurt. A lot of beautiful neighborhoods that survived the war were destroyed. And the main character actually chose to have a Jewish real estate agent. And people were outraged and said, there's no reason that it has to be a Jewish real estate person. It could have been anybody. And he said, well, he followed a classic play. He said, it's misunderstood. He was accused of being anti-Semitic. The head of the German Jewish community staged protests. The play was never done. Only 20 or 25 years later, he said, that's it. I'm not going to do theater anymore. If this can't be discussed, he said, in the play, it goes back and forth. But still, it was some kind of anti-Semitism he was accused of, and perhaps the German left at that time was like this, and perhaps this is also one of the little bit more of the blind sides of that radical 68, 69 student movements. Fassbinder used his work as a springboard for making films. Hana Shigula, who we saw, worked in over 20 films with him when he met her in the acting school. She was in every play. He was highly influenced by Brecht, the Verfremdungseffekt, the alienation effect, that you show your role. You don't really present your text as if you own them. You stay behind it. You present it. You don't stay in front of the text. You just represent something. You show with gestures was important to him. And it was a great, I think, improvisation and a great adaptation of Brecht's ideas. He was very influenced by new French New Wave cinema, Jean-Luc Godard. And because he knew everybody so well, his technicians acted that if together they could move really fast and furious. And he also could get government grants because they knew he would always produce his film. I'm moving a little bit faster. By 1976, 2 years after that theater scandal, he became famous. Internationally, he won prizes at film festivals in Paris, New York, and in Los Angeles. He was actually more well-known outside Germany. People were very critical of his work. They didn't really understand it. But once he was accepted also in Paris and in New York, the New York Times review was very significant. It identified him as a leading voice in European cinema and in theater. But scandals and controversies ensured that Fassbinder was always in the news in Germany, not only living together in a kind of a commune and producing it, but then also he drove Lamborghinis, but his actors weren't paid. He was known to giving some Lamborghinis as gifts for an actor who he liked, and people still had jobs to make their livings, and the company, in a way, was always on the branch of breaking up. His television series, 8 Hours Don't Make a Day, was cut from 8 episodes to 5 by the German television because they felt it was too radical. The significant playwright Franz Xaver Kurz sued Fassbinder about an adaptation of his play. He felt it was obscene. But in Alexanderplatz, the great TV series he created was moved to very, very late night because of young adults that they couldn't really watch what he put out. So it went, there's a long list of complications. By the time he made his last film in 82, Crevel, Fassbinder was consuming heavy doses of drugs and alcohol to sustain his unrelenting work schedules. And the night of June 10th, he was found dead in his room, actually by Juliana, who we're going to talk to later. And the cause of his death was reported as a lethal combination of cocaine and barbiturates. And it was most probably unfortunate, the mixture, and not a suicide. And next to him were found his notes for his next film about Rosa Luxemburg. So that is it so far. Thank you, everybody, for listening and for out there. And we move on. Thank you.
So Juliana is the president of the Fassbinder Foundation, which was founded by Fassbinder's mother right after his death. And she ran it for a couple of years until she was not feeling that she could do it anymore, and basically handed the reins over to Juliana, who the two women were really close. And then since that time, probably for the last 20 years or 25 years, Juliana really has built a foundation that is amazingly well run. So she really, she really promotes his work worldwide. There are new releases of the films, new remakes. I mean, the films are being restored and really spread widely, and there are so many Fassbinder retrospectives across the world. Everything that, you know, is basically due to Juliana and her relentless work in promoting Fassbinder's work and her dedication to his work. She was also the editor of his last films. Oh, thank you. And she's working. Oh, there she is. Hi. Good evening. Juliana, can you hear us?
I don't think we hear the sound.
Yeah? Hello? Hello, hello?
I see everything.
Oh, great. And we can hear you. Can you hear us?
I can hear you, not very well, but I can hear you. I only see a room.
That's
the screen.
True.
Oh, I see myself.
Oh, that's right. I'm here. Hi, Juliana. Thank you so much for doing this. It's 1 a.m. in Germany, so it's really wonderful that you can join us. We promise we don't make it too long, so we have a few questions for you. So this day is dedicated to Fassbinder's stage work. And of course, one question that we have is, how is Fassbinder? There seems to be a resurgence of Fassbinder's work on stage, especially in Germany, I find. Tell us a bit about Fassbinder on stage right now.
Well, there is great development since a few years. What meant Fassbinder after his death was mostly known as a filmmaker, even in Germany. He was more seen on stage abroad, wherever, South America, France, and other countries in Europe. Germans had always a little problem with anything what Fassbinder did, whether on stage or in films. But we are now on his, he has become 70, so we are 33 years after his death. Even 34. So what means people have developed. There is a totally new, wonderful generation, since about 20 years, since the unification especially, it came. And a lot of people from East Germany were interested, always in Fassbinder and especially in this theater work. So I could even not say that it's at the moment in the highest point. I would say there were waves, and as his this year was the 70th anniversary, his 70th anniversary, even the theater festival in Berlin had focused on him in a kind of title like Fassbinder in Focus. And in this city, at the, in springtime, there were about four stage plays of him, like Petra von Kant, in a small theater, in big theaters. There were adaptations, I would say, from his films. The Marriage of Maria Brown, I think it toured also to the US, I think it was a few years ago, and what was it? In Banff. And Mr. Ostermeyer, who is the chief director of the Schaubühne, directed it wonderful, very, very big, wonderful play. Five men played all parts, only Maria Brown was the main character and was a woman. There is Ali Firiz's the Soul, which was never made as a stage play. It's also an adaptation. World on a Wire, I was in New York. I know it was in New York 3 years ago. These are just titles. There is much, much more, and we are sometimes not getting through everything to know. Because still in Germany there is a high culture on stage, and Fassbinder has become, let's say, besides Brecht and Heiner Müller, a main author in repertoire theater and in big theaters.
So, and what did theater mean to him?
Pardon me?
What did theater mean to him? So when?
Well, I sidelined. He was always in Germany when he started in the late 60s with anti-theater, it was called, which didn't mean he was against theater, which could be possible that people think that by the title of his theater. It was written anti and theater without H. But he was very keen with that. It meant we need a new form of theater, but it meant also that in a way, he wrote his plays because of lack of money, because they had no money for stage fees. and with this little or big group of young people who just came from theater, which he met in the end of 1967, which were just starting, and he was a kind of, let's say, pusher. Bringing them together with their energy and with their ideas. And he wrote his first play for these people. He had written a few little plays before. He never spoke about that. But Rainer started to write theater plays always with an idea. It will be also possibly a film. So he mixed theater and film very early, but I remember him once saying that he said, you know, people took you more serious in Germany if you did theater. So that is how we started.
Yeah. So now, if he were still alive, what do you think he would be writing about today? What would he be writing about? So what would
he be writing about? Oh my God, there is enough. Right about, because our world is not in order since a few years, as we know that, and especially after this weekend in Europe, we are again in this kind of state of no return, thinking, what do we do in the future? It is not war, what people say, but there were big attacks in Paris, and what does that mean? From where does it come? It didn't arrive from yesterday to today. There is a development. It is a social situation. We all know about it. You had September 11. I think he wouldn't have written too much about this if he wouldn't have lived in America, as he was a very European person. I guess in the last 10 years he would have had, even 20 years, he would have had a lot of material. And you will have that too, I guess.
Okay, thank you so much, Rihanna. So we don't want to take up too much of your time. That was great.
She can watch the three scenes. She can stay on Skype and watch the three scenes.
Oh, that's right. Frank was just saying it's live screened what we're doing here. So you could actually stay on and watch the three scenes that are being performed here now.
I would be happy.
Yeah, so I think you have to connect the link. So, but we will send you the link to actually, watch these three scenes.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
So how many people are it?
In your people?
30, 40 people.
Yeah.
But let's go to the next scene and
that's right. Yes, so we're going to move on to our first scene. Thank you so much, Rihanna. That was really, really wonderful. And thanks for joining us.
The action takes place in Bremen around 1820.
Quiet!
Biscuits and gravy?
Mother Clara Mathilde Steinbacher, taken from us by the good Lord.
Quiet!
Brandy. Miss Constant, the hour will be the death of me. More coffee. So, the execution is to take place Friday, November 3rd, 1814, in the Market Square. Brandy. When I say brandy, woman, I mean the bottle, not a few measly drops. Here's to you. Cigar? Light? Hot here. I'll have one evening of peace in this house. Quiet! Shut the windows. Another ghost spotted in Bremen. I mean, we don't need the fire that intense. Strange things occurring in this city. Prepare my nightcap. It's a headache.
Quiet!
My medicine.
He looks at her, a long, ominous pause. Then he sets the newspaper down, slowly rises, approaches Guiche. For a moment, one has the feeling he wants to embrace her. But then he starts hitting her, quite brutally. Until she lies sobbing on the floor. He stands over her. A knock at the door. Milton Berger opens. Godfrey, Zimmerman, and Ruth enter.
They are very drunk.
Godfrey sees Guiche and goes to her.
We were just passing by, brother. In this distillery, there's so much liquor.
Better to serve my friends. Make yourself comfortable.
Sooner said than done. Rather cold out there.
Your wife, she's lying on the floor, crying.
One of her fainting spells. Guiche! Brandy!
Down, Wendell Christoph. Gather ye rosebuds while you may. Hear about Retta and Rhea?
They've shut her place down.
They shut it down. Shut it down. Three of the girls are infected. They're infected. VD, your arm. VD? No, that's not. Which girls?
Carmen.
No.
Jacine.
No.
Marie-Louise and Black.
No, again.
Freedom of us, we're up the hook. I bet it won't be long before one of our solid Brennan citizens is the proud father of a syphilitic prick.
Children's father.
man is strangling the mother of his children with bare hands. Her eyes poke out of her head, naturally. He asks her, ice cold tone of voice, "Hey, what do you think you're staring at?"
A man is going at it with a woman. Gets a little carried away, bites her tip. Afterwards, he says, "Well, don't blame the kid on me."
"Which kid?"
"You're pregnant. You're filled up with milk."
"Milk? You got it all wrong. That was a boil. But thanks anyway for popping it."
Have to see just how much my wife loves me. Geisha, come here. Say, "I love you."
"I love you."
Say, "I want you."
"I want you."
They laugh. Geisha cries. My wife! She knows who's boss.
Go get some
Brandy!
She knows the meaning of humility. And then that, Jesus Christ, she's like a wild mare in heat. Just right for someone who's got what I do. Yippee!
There's an execution on Friday. I almost get hard the split second before the axe.
What goes through the condemned man's mind the last few seconds? What does he feel? What? It's crazy.
I'm going home. It's been a long day.
So, we're off. Until tomorrow, little hunger, heart.
Till next time.
She remains still. He staggers towards her. She tries to evade him, but he catches her, proceeds to paw her.
"Don't be absurd, woman. You have to learn who's master of this house, who's entitled to his little privileges."
He wrestles her into the bedroom, knocks her down again, kisses her. Scene change. Through lighting or other methods. Nelson Berger answers.
"Ah! Ah! Help me! Ah! I'm on fire! Geisha! Geisha!"
Geisha answers.
"Don't just stay here, help me get a doctor! I love you.
this eventually became, it was written as a play, and it eventually became his second film. It will be directed by Ashley Tucker. Oh, okay, so, Marie belongs to Erich. Paul speaks, that's the scene, that's where we're starting, right? That's the scene where we're...
That's his, what he wrote at the beginning of his program.
So, okay. Marie belongs to Erich. Paul speaks with Helga. Peter lets himself be kept by Elizabeth. Rosie does it with funds for money. In the back court, in the tavern, in their flats, they meet singly in couples as a group and exchange opinions, become aggressive, get bored, piss off one another and drink. The fact that Helga, who belongs to Paul, gets involved with his friend Erich, or that Peter is getting fed up.
Thank you.
Everybody's talking. There has to be something to it.
No one knows nothing. Nothing.
What happened? Happened. Okay? That's it.
And what happened then?
You had a thing going. That's what happened.
Nothing happened. Happened. Happened! I had a bunch of crap with him, not it! I love you so much, but I have a funny feeling.
Funny feeling?
About the others? They're getting ready for something nasty.
No, I understand.
All of a sudden, they... Bang, bang!
No, bang, bang.
Because you're so nice. Still gonna take me to Greece with you?
Go Greece together.
And your wife?
No, I understand.
Your wife? Yorgo's wife?
No, I understand.
Because it really got to me. They all know. But it doesn't bother me.
I'm for the leather jackets. If you're gonna go for it, go for it.
What do they cost? 300?
Christ.
But there are those American jackets. The blue ones? You can stick something on the back. Chicago Rockers? Something like that?
Better nothing.
And everyone needs a set of knuckles. Get that in your pocket, you're flying. Hey, Bruno's in too. He told me.
What's that about? Leather jackets would still be better.
And then there's marriage. Don't you want to get married?
No.
Married life, now that's something. Don't underestimate the steady life.
You never know.
You didn't hear what they were saying about us?
You're supposed to understand all the time.
No, but it's what they say that's important. You... me, understand?
Understand.
Because they all got something for you. But you've been with Marie, right?
Marie, beautiful girl.
Oh, and me?
Much beautiful.
Oh, so. What about it? With me?
You, happy with your foreigner?
More than with you.
Because you're just a slut.
That's what makes me unhappy with you.
Morals don't mean nothing to
you. Why do you have to fight?
What's he got that I don't?
That's my business.
Someone ought to hammer you in your fat mouth. Pissed off, that's all.
No! Look who's coming our way!
Yeah, look who's coming our way. Watch out.
Green. Perfect timing.
Shit face! Hey! What are you doing walking over here? You think just anyone can walk over here?
Nothing to say?
No understand.
Yeah, you understand your commie. Well, hit me back, come over here!
Nice one.
So don't forget, you calm bastard.
Get one!
Shut your face, will you? Look, just so you don't forget how things are gonna be for you from now on.
It had to happen sooner or later. The way he carried on here like he belonged. The way he looked at you like meat in a butcher store. It won't stop here. Not till he's had enough. He's got to go. Right? We gotta get back to normal.
We had to get revenge.
Right.
Did he get up again?
Done on the left.
Who cares?
Right.
He's gonna go for sure.
For sure.
Because things ain't so nice anymore.
We're the only ones who belong here.
You didn't have to go in with him. That wasn't necessary.
No, understand.
Just
why.
Just came over me.
I don't understand why.
I know how.
Bang, bang.
It's over. Now. Bunch of bull to me.
Oh, bang, bang.
Come on, hold me.
Oh.
nice. Germany, much cold.
Kiss me. I need you. So, is he going?
No.
And you didn't tell Elizabeth she won't get off any better next time?
Yeah, but she doesn't believe it.
She's crazy.
It's easy to see what's better for her.
She says it's better for business.
And you say it.
Yeah. Yeah, right, because it's true.
How come?
Because we produce more now, and she only pays him 650 marks. He sleeps in my room, and she deducts 150 marks for that.
150? That's allowed?
Right. And for food, another 180. That comes to 330 marks. She pays him 320 marks.
Not bad.
That's what the man from the Foreign Labor Department in Munich told her. You have to do it that way, because then it's more productive. Because they're here, and the money stays in the country.
So that's how it is.
Yeah, right. It's a trick for Germany's sake.
She knows about business, though, Elizabeth. I always said so.
She's not going to ship anyone out, she told me. Most likely, she'll get another one.
You need savvy. It's what it takes.
So in March, I'm joining the army, because it beats working here.
I'm going to have to, too.
That's for me. I want to be in a submarine, because it's different from being on the land, I mean.
You have to go where they tell you.
Who cares where you go, anyway?
You'll be having a new colleague in January. A Turk. He's too old for construction or something.
Turk?
A Turk is coming here. Work, like you.
Turkish no good. Others no?
No, because I have to take what they send me.
Turkish no. Yorgos and Turkish no work together. Yorgos go other town.
He's taking me to Greece with him in the summer. What about his wife? Doesn't make any difference. It's not the same in Greece. I don't know. Just going away like that. It's so far, too.
All planned,
it. Oh, you disgust me. Nothing more than a filthy little whore. Oh, and I love you so, so much. I'm so madly in love with you. If you know how much it hurts. I want you to feel like this sometime. I want you to be lost. Everything will seem so different. You're so stupid, so fucking thick. We could have been so happy together. So happy. One of these days you'll realize that. Only then, it'll be too late. Far too late. Trust me, I shall be avenged. Ding! Money! Happy birthday! Oh, it's you, Gabby.
Isn't Grandma here?
No.
I've got masses to tell you.
Of course, my child, you do. Marlene! Make us some coffee!
I mean, the flight, you should have been there. The plane should have, like, this much. I got really rough. Oh, Mommy, I haven't seen you for so long, my lovely, lovely Mommy. 4 months. Is Karin here?
No.
No? She will be coming, though, won't she?
No, I don't think she will.
Well, doesn't matter. Never liked her much anyway.
Didn't you?
Well, you know, she is... She's pretty common, isn't she?
No, she is not!
Anyway... Oh, Mommy, I feel so sad. So unhappy.
Unhappy?
No, actually, I'm incredibly happy, but I don't know, Mommy. It's all so complicated.
What's wrong?
Mommy, I'm in love.
You? No, that's too funny. You're in love.
I didn't expect you to be like that, Mommy. Honestly, you're so narrow-minded.
Oh, I'm sorry, my child, I'm sorry. But to me, you're still my little girl. Thinking of you as a grown-up is going to take some getting used to.
Try, please.
Okay, then, Gabby. Tell me about your boyfriend.
Oh, that's just it. Mommy, he isn't my boyfriend. Not yet. He doesn't know about me loving him. He's so uncaring, you wouldn't believe. I've been trying to flirt with him for like 3 weeks, and he completely ignores me. He behaves like I don't exist. Oh, Mommy, it's so awful.
That'll change, Gabby. Believe me.
Oh, Mommy, he's so gorgeous. I can't imagine how gorgeous he is.
Yes, I can. He's very tall and slim with blonde hair. And he looks a little bit like Sam Neill.
How did you know that?
Oh, I'm not telling.
You're so clever, Mommy. I got the cleverest mother in the whole world. Bring. Bring. Bring.
Yes. No!
Mommy, Mommy, say something. What's the matter? Please don't cry, Mommy. What is happening?
Oh, nothing, Gabby. It's nothing. You can stop crying. Nothing has happened. You can go get the cake and the cream ready.
So badly, Mommy?
Because she deserves no better. And actually, she doesn't want it any other way. She's happy like that. You understand?
No.
Oh, for God's sake, there's no need to go worrying about the health.
I won't argue with you on your birthday, Mother, but you ought to be aware that on this subject, our views differ.
All right. Children should be encouraged to form their own opinions. That is the current thinking, isn't it?
Ding dong!
I'll get it. Stay there. May I present Baroness Sidonie von Grasnacht.
Petra, darling.
Sidonie.
A very happy birthday, Petra. With all my heart. Open it later. How's school, Gabby?
could do better. Auntie Sidonie.
As long as you pass, that's the main thing.
Marlena! Another cup, quick! I think Mommy mistreats Marlena, don't you?
Gabby. I agree, Gabby. You're not old enough to judge your mother's behavior.
All right. I won't say anything then.
Darling, how are you?
How am I supposed to be? Fine.
Thank you. So, tell me. I read all about your success in Milan. Congratulations.
Oh, I'm bored with all that crap.
Don't laugh.
Let her laugh.
Go on and laugh. You want to say you can laugh.
I'm fed up with the whole business. I can do nothing but design stuff and travel all the time and worry whether anyone's going to like it. It's always the same. And for what?
Because it's obvious. Because you have to live, Petra. Because you have to work in order to, if you want to earn money, and because you need money if you're going to live.
But that's just it. Work used to be fun. Now it's sucked all the life out of me. It's gone. Over. The cake. She's doing that just to annoy me.
Oh, I don't think so, Petra. Gabby, there's no need for that. Have you heard from Karin at all? Karin?
No. Have you?
Well, I happen to know she's working for Poochie.
Oh. Poochie.
Yeah. Very talented girl. Going to have a big career, that's certain.
Talented? She's not talented, Sidonie. She just knows how to sell herself.
I'm not sure your queen being quite fair on her, Petra. Maybe your judgment's a little too subjective. She's here, by the way, today, in Cologne.
She is. You are splendidly well informed, darling.
Really? To be honest, I wouldn't have known either if Karin hadn't called me this morning.
Did you tell her?
Of course. I told her it was your birthday, darling, and she said she'd try to drop in, but she wasn't at all sure. She's frightfully busy. Yes.
She's frightfully busy. Oh, yeah. Don't tell me.
Stop drinking so much. You need to watch yourself, Petra. People can get dropped a lot faster than you think.
Oh, Petra, I'm so sorry. I've waited and waited and the cat still wouldn't come. Happy birthday. Is anyone else coming?
No.
Well, let's all sit down, shall we? Oh, sit on me. You get younger and younger.
Hello, Auntie. It's simple. It's because I'm happy.
Oh, the traffic in this city is deadly. Well, Gabby, I'm not school.
She's okay.
Have you been arguing?
I've been forbidden to speak, Grandma.
That's not true, Gabby.
You've forbidden me to have an opinion,
no,
haven't you?
No, I've forbidden you to do anything. That's a downright lie.
You did stop me saying something.
Oh, hold it, child.
And calm down, children. Let's all be nice to one another.
You all make me sick.
I beg your pardon.
Please sit down. What's the matter, child?
You're such hypocrites. The lot of you miserable little hypocritical bastards. Not if you have any idea.
Money.
Oh, you revolting child. I hate you. I hate all of you.
Oh, money. Money.
Get your hands off of me. Marlena, get me a gin and tonic. If you knew what scum you are. Cheers, you bunch of parasites.
What's got into her?
Poor thing.
I am not poor. I can see you with a fresh pair of eyes, that's all. And it makes me want to throw up. Oh, you're going to tear down the whole mouth. So what? Did you work for it? You never so much as bit a finger in your entire life. First,
than me. You know what I think you are? A whore. Mother of rancid! Clown out! Old whore! Oh, yeah!
Mommy!
I work for it so I can live as much as I want, understand?
I don't understand any of this. What have we done to you?
Well, it's all because of that girl.
What girl?
Karin! Everyone knows Petra's mad about Karin.
Mad? I am not mad, Sidonie. I am in love with her. I love her like I've never loved anything in my life.
You love her? You love her? Love? A girl? Oh, Petra. Petra!
That girl's little finger is worth more than all of you put together. Oh, Karin.
Mommy, please. Mommy.
Get away from me, you monster! Jen and Tonic, Marlena! 10 Jen and Tonics!
My daughter's in love with a girl! A girl! My daughter! Oh god, this is terrible.
Bring. Karin. No, no! I never want to see you again in my life. Never, do you hear? Never, ever! Oh, you're going to suffer for that, Petra. I'll make sure of it. I'm not going to suffer for anything anymore. I'm suffering so much already. Anyone else want to go? The door is open. Saw it off. I have nothing left to give. I am bothered. Jen! Marlene! Or are you going to piss off too? What are you crying for? What is it? You're happy. Happy, all of you!
Oh my child. My poor, poor child.
I want to die, Mommy. I really want to die. I've nothing on earth left to give. When you're dead, everything's calm. Everything's beautiful. And peaceful, Mommy. Everything's peaceful.
Mommy, I'm so fond of you.
You take pills, Mommy. Just put them in a glass of water, swallow them, and go to sleep. Sleep's wonderful, Mommy. I haven't slept for so long. I want to sleep. For a long, long time.
Discussion.
Jessica Rogato, she directed Brave and Freedom. Caitlin Ryan O'Connell directed Bitter Tears of Pitcher from Kant. And Ashley Tata directed Katzenmacher. Okay, so, and Ryan Henschker, thank you so much for joining the discussion. We just have a bunch of quick questions, and then I would love to open it to the audience. So, when did you, and this question is for all three of you, so when did you discover Fassbinder?
Really? I guess when I was an undergrad at NYU, I had to do scene work on Bitter Tears. And I was a horrible mismatch for that. I played Corinne. It was a nightmare. Things have certainly changed over the last decade. So that was my first encounter. And then with the actual like stage play text. And then I remember being really high with my roommate in college a little while after we tried to watch the film version of it. And I was like, this is so slow. I hate this. And then I ended up loving Fassbinder years later, but that was like my first encounter.
I saw a few of Fassbinder's films when I was an undergrad at Wellesley and didn't really know much about him then. And then I'm in grad school at Brown right now, and my second year I was looking for something different, brutal, huge, and I was talking to Eric and he said you have to read all of Fassbinder's plays, and I was like, he wrote plays? And then I looked into it, and so it's just been like two years now that I've like spent more time with him and his writing and his work.
I remember Fassbinder, a mentor of mine was working on Year 13 Moons, and he suggested that I watch the DVD, and I brought it the night that I met my boyfriend's parents to their house, and I said, we should watch this movie together.
That's great. So, now, Caitlin, you also directed that play not too long ago.
Yeah, last spring we did a full production at Brown.
Yeah, and that was, can you tell us a little bit also about your...
Yeah, sure. So we do our shows in a bank downtown in Providence, and so you can basically do whatever you want with the design collaborators, and it's the first time you get to work with them your second year. And so we designed like this curated art gallery space where there were stanchions and three sort of stanchioned off squares, and that was like where Petra and her people lived, and the audience could move around and sort of have this voyeuristic experience of the play, and the movie was playing on a little TV, and there was lots of mannequins and a bathtub full of Tab, and I got Coca-Cola that donated like 200 cans of Tab, and so everything was like based off the color scheme of Tab, and there were balloons, and so none of the people that you saw were in that, but some of them were Brown alums, and yeah, it was wild. It was a mess, but really fun.
That was also the concept to use.
Oh yeah, sorry. And I also used, I had three women available and then the rest of the males in my class, and I really wanted to do the play. And I also think that it's an interesting thing to do with his work because he's constantly talking about men and women, and it was a man who wrote a play about women, so I felt like he was in every character. And there's this a lot to talk about when we talk about sexuality and gender with his work, so I did use three men in the roles that you saw him in today.
Which actually brings me to the next question. So what is it that resonates in his work for you, for all three of you? So where's the way in, where's this like, oh, that's something that's...
It feels so funny to use this mic because you can all hear. Is this for like a recording? Is that why? Okay. I don't know how to be succinct about it. I do think what compels me about Fassbinder is also what terrifies me in myself. which is his, what appears to me, his pursuit of freedom at all costs, which is a way that I'm terrified to live, but would like to aspire toward. So that's tremendously inspiring. I also think that he is so elegantly able to like bang you on the head with like a passionate idea. It feels like he cares about and is intentional in all of his gestures. I mean that, he's just like, I just feel like he's like holding up a sign that says, I feel this, I believe this. And he like does, he's unwavering in that. And I really, really love that. I love, I mean, it's coming from Wrecked, I suppose, but I love how explicit it is. Yeah.
That was such a good answer. I feel the same in a different way, I think. I feel like he's not afraid of putting anything in front of us and showing us the taboo or what people say is taboo, but what is so human. And it's terrifying to me, and it forces me to be bolder as an artist when I encounter his work or read him or think about him. It can take, like, his work is full of the extremes, so like you could do anything stylistically with his work, and there's such also this haunting, frightening, real, raw human underneath it all that seems to speak directly to us. And so even though their style and like, you know, in Act 4, what you just saw, like extreme style, the whole play doesn't live there. It goes like a roller coaster through many different styles and tones, and it can kind of, yeah, it's like a scary, terrifying, but needed recognition, I think, that we're all sort of addicted to once we start encountering him.
With the material, it was interesting doing this piece right now. You know, we worked on it a bit last night, and then today, before coming here, listening to Obama's address at the summit, and then having a little bit of conversation with the actors about how these themes of are continuing to resonate. And so there's this he's able to kind of what's deeply compelling about the humans, and for me at least, obviously, the humans and the pieces is this kind of this real longing and real desire for love and acceptance, I find, and they're all kind of trying their best to do that, and also be, but then they're also who they are, and so frequently I find that you follow these characters through a journey, and you're kind of like, yeah, no, totally, I see why you're doing that, but that's really not okay to be doing, but I see why you're doing it, and you come out the other end, and you realize that they're doing the things that you probably are doing on a day-to-day basis without realizing it, and that is always, like, that's the journey that we're taking on, but it's within the society at large that kind of implicitly sets that up for us, kind of that journey for us to be going on. And so it's a really human portrayal of what finally is this, like, the structure around us at all times.
Yeah. Would love to also open it up to the audience. Are there any questions that you want to ask?
I think it's probably the light for the audience. any questions or comments?
For the two directors who adapted the stage versions, did both of you purposely see the movies, Katzenmacher and Literatures of Petrovan Pan, before you saw this, or did you try to avoid seeing the movie? Did you try just to work from the play as a play?
Yeah, I haven't seen the movie in years. I don't usually try and watch other things other versions of things I'm about to do, just because I really want to see what the text is telling me to do with it. So I did see it like years and years ago, and so I have like vague memories of it, images, but no, I haven't watched it. And I tried to get my cast not to watch it, but some of them did.
Cosmos Mother was a play first that then he made into a film. I actually saw the play first in New York at NYU, and then saw that was a couple years ago, and then saw the film quickly thereafter. And then when this opportunity came up, Antia sent me the play, and I was like, how is it possible that this play, it's like 20 pages, how is it possible this is a full-length film? And what we did not do is, it's just so much, it's just the portrait and the composition, and compositionally it's beautiful, and it's just people sitting in these situations, and I didn't do that,
And just to say, you can watch all of that, what Frank was showing excerpts of, you can watch all of Berlin Freedom on YouTube. That stage version is like an hour and 40 minutes long, and I actively did not watch it. I started watching it, and then I stopped, and then I realized later that any ways in which my staging ended up aligning with his staging seemed to be like pure demands of the text, which I wanted to resist. I had like a different idea about the text, or like I wanted to try something on it, and then like the text didn't make sense. Like, it's not awesome. Like, the text was stronger than my idea. Yeah.
Justin, I actually ask you a question about that text.
Yeah.
Do you have the
can ask me.
Did he, because in the Cosmogra there's no stage direction at all, and like kind of scenes maybe are indicated by a series of asterisks. And so there are these, I was like, oh, it's kind of like doing Shakespeare because, you know, get your hands off of me. I guess your hands were on them, you know.
Yeah.
Were there stage directions in that piece?
Oh, yeah. Like everything that James, I don't know everything that James read was a stage direction. But I know
I'm so sorry. That's actually stupid.
It's not.
So, it's like I'm so sorry.
You just saw a lot of theater. It's a little situation. But then there are stage directions missing all over the place, and it is like that Shakespeare thing, or where you feel where the next line like just jumps a feeling, and you're like, oh, I gotta fill that in. Why are all those ellipses there? Well, what is she doing in those ellipses? Like, what is he doing in those ellipses? Like, that first speech that Jason has to give is like just a list of words. Just a list of words. Yeah.
That, what we saw actually in the Rainer Werner Freedom was a movie made for TV. So it wasn't actually a staged filming.
Yeah, I read about it. I mean, he did it on stage, and then they did this TV version of it, right?
Yeah,
but they did that, like, I mean, that's what's, like, Asha, this is what's insane to me about imagining being, like, a producing artist in Germany in the 70s. Just the ability to, I mean, he's obviously a virtuoso, but the ability to make that much work nonstop. I can't figure out a paradigm. Like, in my life, I don't think I will ever know that. To be creative in that way. I mean, even like sans substance. You know what I mean? But like, you have an idea and you put it on TV. Like, I don't think we see that very often. Like, I guess we have YouTube and the internet, but that's like so much more beautiful and exciting. I mean, maybe it'd be sentimental, but.
Yeah. I mean, are you talking about the opportunities that he had that he actually.
Yeah, I mean, I guess we could have a whole conversation about
that. That was also later in his career, but that he was commissioned to actually, create these TV series or something, or by one of our TV stations. I mean, in Germany. So yeah, no, it's true. I mean, the sheer madness of his output is kind of wild. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So do we have another? There was.
Thank you. I just was, you know, reminded so much of Lucky in Beckett's Waiting for Godot in the first picture. Was that conscious? Was that not?
No. No, but I feel like I have to like go back and read that play now. You brought that up.
So do we maybe have one more question, then we will have a little reception afterwards?
Thanks so much, that was beautiful. I really loved what you guys did. I love Fassbinder myself. I'm curious, number one, your favorite Fassbinder film, and why? Just really out of curiosity. And I'm very fascinated because that he worked with nothing, I guess, for a long time. I mean, I don't know how long, was it like many years? What do you think about that? And is it possible to then work with something and recreate somebody who can work with nothing? You know what I mean? Like, what's the, does that formally create a problem? Because you guys seem to, a couple of you seem to be working at institutions and with large crews and stuff. And everyone's, you know, being able to design something in a bank and all these things.
Yeah, not a lot. I mean, it's.
No, I'm just curious about what you think about that problem. And like,
it's a great question. I think we should do more things with less. I think that's. That, like, there's. So a new form of theater coming up where we just make more with less, and I'm into that. I think it's important, and I think it works for so much, and it and my favorite scene is from Fassbinder is I can't remember which movie it's from. It's the slaughterhouse scene.
Year
13 Moons. Thank you. Have you seen that scene? So good. It's you're in a slaughterhouse, and there, and you also see two characters having a conversation. And you see their feet walking by all these cows that are being killed in front of you.
She's in heels.
Yes, in heels. And Fassbinder's playing the lead character. No, just kidding. I lied. There's heels.
What's that?
Who is it who plays
the? The name, but it's he was very cool. It's
so good, yeah, so good. That's my favorite scene. It's incredible, and I also I think it's also about like he forces us to like see revulsion, be repulsed, and be attracted to so much. And I think that there's a lot of intolerance in the world, like extreme intolerance, and there's extreme examination of intolerance in his work, and that's, I think, why we should keep doing it, and doing it with very little.
I think, because I'm actually also doing a lot with very little, and I think a lot of us are in that world and continue to do that, and I think it's really exciting what you can do with very little. I do think that we're in a place where a lot of us are creating with the expectation that we shouldn't ask for anything or that we won't get anything, and I think that that should end. So I'm actually of a place of, I mean, yeah, sure, we can do a lot with little, but we shouldn't be expected to. I think that, you know, Fassbinder and his trajectory and what he did is very exciting, in that you can put out a lot of work and you can demand excellence from yourself and your peers and your audience. But I think that tied into that is we should also expect more from our from institutions. And so I just wanted to say that. My current Fassbinder obsession movie is I Only Want You to Love Me, which is a film that like very few people know that he made, to the point where I actually check this on a daily basis, as I say, it's my favorite film of his. And they're like, people who really know his work have not heard of it. So that's my favorite Fassbinder film right now. It's a really beautiful piece about two people who are, trying to make a life for themselves, and what it is to ask somebody to love, and how do you actually show love to a person, and like, and are equipped to do that.
No, here's the bedroom mic. Well, like speaking to working with few resources. I was just like at the O'Neill Center last week, like at their acting program. I was like doing a residency for another project, and was so blown away by what was going on in this particular place. Because there are like students there who are all like in their very early 20s, and they work 7 days a week, 7:30 to 10 every day. So creativity in this really incredible way is just kind of flowing through them all the time, because they're forced to produce art like all day long. Like they get scenes on like Wednesdays and they put them up on Friday, like off book, like really poor theater, like whatever. And they're like working off a Grotowski model as well. They're like, and they're gonna do it with their bodies, they're gonna do it with the trash in the room, and they have like maybe like some like skeletal boxes that they'll use to like create walls and shit. And that was really amazing. But like always like even underneath that kind of like underneath what we call poor theater, there's like larger systemic stuff that supports that, like those, so for example, like Fassbinder working with nothing, but also sort of having like people coming out of a theater program who wanted to show some allegiance to him and potentially didn't have to work so much that they could actually function as an ensemble and know each other, and like no amount of like green money in hand can like show you that on the surface, but like that's like a huge resource, is people like intuiting each other like that and him being able to work with that body. So like that's the deeper thing. Like, so I know like that's what I would like from the art practice, is to be able to like keep an ensemble around and figure out how to keep an ensemble around. Which involves space and time, but it doesn't necessarily involve objects. So, but that's still a cost. And my favorite, I don't want to take yours, I mean, that scene is amazing. It's probably, like, yeah, my favorite monologue ever written as a piece of text. But I'll say, like, tonight, The Marriage of Maria Braun. I'll say that. Yeah.
Okay, so then, thank you so very much for coming.